In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground.
And that place is called Calvary. And that person is called Jesus.
What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still.
If you were here with us Wednesday night, we were in Luke chapter 8. And we were discussed and looked into the parable that Jesus taught about the seed and the sower. And Jesus was teaching his disciples and teaching the crowds around him this parable. And what we need to understand and what I've been taught is this parable is the key. It is like the dictionary to the other parables you'll read. And in that parable, Jesus is talking about there was a farmer, and he went and sowed some seed on different types of ground. And we learned that the seed is the Word of God. And we learned that the sower is the Holy Spirit, it's God Himself. He's the one doing the sowing. And the ground is our hearts and our souls. And Jesus gave the different types of ground, and he discussed that, basically the different types of people that hear the word and how they receive it. And Jesus said, you know, there are some folks who hear the word, but they never receive it because the devil comes and snatches it away. And what we found out is that these are the folks who they hear God's word, and we know that faith comes through hearing and hearing through the word of God. But what they do, because God loves us enough and gave us free will to choose, they chose the world. They chose sin. They chose the present life over God's word. Then we learned in the second type of soul was rocky soil, and it says the folks who heard that word, they received it with joy. As soon as they heard it, they received it with joy. But because the seed didn't have any deep roots, when the sun came and dried out and withered, Jesus said, these are the folks who receive the word with joy, but when troubles and trials come along, they fall back, fall away. Now, that doesn't mean they lose their salvation. What we would say about these folks are these are the folks who have their fire insurance only. You know, you'll see them, they receive the word with joy and they believe, get baptized, but then as Pastor Timmy says, you can't find them anymore. You can't see, you don't know where they're at. That's what he's talking about here. Nothing is produced. And Paul talks about these folks, and so does Jesus. Jesus said in the latter days, if it were even possible, these folks would be led astray by false prophets. But no one is able to snatch us from our Father's hand who has saved us, not even ourselves. No one is greater than the Father. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Then Jesus talked to us about a third type of person. He said that there was some seed that fell among the thorns, and when the crop came up, it wasn't able to mature. And you know, we talked about how you can ride around in our area. Ours is a farm community, and you can see a lot of times where a field that hasn't had herbicide sprayed on it or hasn't been looked after much, the soybeans or wheat or whatever it is might come up, and there are a lot of weeds in that field, and the crop's just not able to produce, mature like it should, because all the nutrients and everything's being sucked away from it. Jesus said these are the type of folks that get saved, they receive the word. But then as life goes on, and we talked about it, they said they're distracted. And we talked about Martha and Mary, that the cares and the concerns of this world just tend to be on the forefront. That the devil can't defeat us, he can't keep us from being saved, he can't get us out of heaven, he can't snatch us out of our hands. But what he can do is distract us with troubles and work, family concerns, and health problems, financial problems, whatever it may be, we all have them. And then we get distracted, and all of a sudden we're focused on those things instead of on Jesus. Then lastly, Jesus said, hey, there's some seed that fell on the good soil, and it produced a great crop, bountiful harvest, 100 times fold of what was seeded. And Jesus said, these are the folks who received the word, and they cling to it. They hold on to it, waiting patiently for a great crop to be produced through Christ. So as we're talking about this, and I've been studying through Luke and reflecting and trying to see what God would have for me to bring forth as a sermon this past several weeks, staying in Luke, we look at this and we say, okay, Daniel, I understand this. But based on what? You're giving me these analogies. Jesus is telling me this parable of producing a crop, and he's saying that I'm supposed to be fruitful, but based on what? Based on what? Says who? You remember when you were a kid, somebody would come out there and it's like, hey, you need to go do this, and you'd say, says who? Based on what? Well, that's what we're going to look at this morning, is based on what? We're going to be in Luke chapter 6 this morning. I want to give you the background here. Jesus has been up on the mountain with his disciples, and he's been teaching. And during that time, he's chosen 12 apostles out of the disciples that are going to be his close followers, the ones, the apostles, the ones called, the ones sent, the ones who are going to have that close relationship with the Lord, one of whom will ultimately betray him. These are the folks who will go out and spread the gospel like wildfire. That something happens in their life that sets them on such fire that they're willing to die for it and do. But they're so convicted by it. But as he comes down from the mountain with his apostles and the disciples that are with him, there's a great crowd gathered there. And the Bible says that they've come as far as Tyre and Sidon. That's well north of where they're at. Now, to us, it wouldn't even be a day's journey in a car. You know, we can go to another state. I was talking about it this morning. We can go to another state and hear a preacher preach and be able to be back home at night. You know, we can do those things. But to this, they had to walk it. And they didn't have fast food restaurants along the way to stop at or grocery stores or whatever it be to stop at along the way. They had to carry it with them, cook it outside, do whatever they had to do. There just weren't places to stay. So this was a big thing. Obviously, these folks had heard of Jesus, his power, his miracles, and his teaching, and it says Jesus taught with authority. It wasn't like a priest saying, well, this is what it says, or like I'm, this is what it says. It says, Jesus himself says, I tell you, I'm instructing you, the Son of Man. And he's backing it up with his miracles and his power and authority. And people have heard, and his name is spread like wildfire. So these folks have come down, and it said hordes of people were at the base of this mountain. And Jesus comes down, it says they were pressing in on him. Because power was coming from him and people were being healed just who were around him. And they wanted to hear what he had to say, but, you know, it says a lot of them wanted that healing. So Jesus begins to preach to him. He takes this opportunity, starts talking to him. And this is where you see the Beatitudes, the Sermon of the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst. Blessed are those who seek after righteousness. And he gives all the blessings start to come down. And then he goes further, and he talks about that are the sorrows that are going to happen for people who cling to this world. And then he gets radical, and he says, love your enemies and don't hate them. And he's talking to Israelites, folks that are being oppressed by the Roman Empire, who have had their lands stolen, their family members killed, the riches taken from them. They're oppressed at the time, and he says, no, you're to love them. You're to pray for them. Man, this is getting radical for them. And then he goes further and he says, and on top of that, don't judge them. And he gives a description of a person with a big log in his eye. You can just see it. Don't say Jesus didn't have a sense of humor. He's got his big plank in his eye and trying to look for a little bitty speck in his brother's to get it out. He said, you know, hey, get that log out of your eye first and you'll be able to see to get the speck out of your brother's eye. And he's telling them these things, and they're listening. And then he picks it up, and in verse 43, you don't have to follow there yet. In verse 43 of chapter 6 in that same chapter, he says, okay, a good tree can't produce bad fruit, and a bad tree can't produce good fruit. Now, I'm reading out of the New Living Translation, so you follow me if you're in the New King James. If you follow me, if you're in the King James, if you're in the New American Standard, it's all the same. What's most important is that you read it and apply it. So you follow along with me. I'll call out the verses. It said, figs are never gathered from thorn bushes and grapes aren't picked from bramble bushes or weeds. Verse 45, a good person produces good things from the treasure of a good heart, and an evil person produces evil things from the treasure of an evil heart. What you say flows from what's in your heart. Jesus lays down this preference, and he says, listen, if you're going to recognize where you're getting the fruit from, and basically the question is, are you good or bad? That's where it comes down to. So let's go back to the parable about the seed and sower. What kind of soil are you? Or have you even received the word? If you haven't received the word, you can't even produce a good crop. You can't eat, the tree that this fruit's being picked from is bad. Are you a good tree to where someone can pick good fruit? Are you producing a crop? Same preference. So our lesson here is going to pick up in 46, verse 46. Basically, someone's going to say, you're going to give them some instruction, and they're going to say, based on what? Where did you hear that? How do you know that? And this is where we pick it up. Verse 46, Jesus had just told them about the trees, and so this is what he says. And the Bible is not this cherry-picking thing to where God is talking about something here, and that's one thing, and then he's talking about something else, and that's another thing. And we don't apply this to that, and it's really hard when you see those chapter breaks and all there to understand Jesus is continually speaking. So he tells him about the fruit, and he goes straight on. He says, so why do you keep calling me Lord, Lord, when you don't do what I say? Now understand, he's come down from the mountain. They're all pressing in on him. Folks want to be healed. Folks are saying, what do we do? How does this work? And Jesus starts to tell them, he starts preaching to them, and so they're still coming to him asking these questions, and he said, listen, you ought to be able to know for yourself that you can't pick good things in bad areas and you can't pick bad things in good areas. That just doesn't work. So, if you know these things, why do you keep asking me, but you don't do what I say? Church, why do you keep coming here if you're not willing to move? That's the premise. Are you producing a crop? That's it. Based on what, Daniel? All right, so let's move forward. Jesus says, okay, I'll show you what it's like. He says, I'm going to draw you a word picture, and here it is. When someone comes to me, listens to my teaching, and then follows it, that's what I'm going to show you. Verse 48. It's like a person building a house who digs deep, lays the foundation on the solid rock, and when the floodwaters rise and break against it, the house stands firm because it is well built. So based on what? It's based on the foundation of God. It's based on the fact that He is Lord and Savior, that what He says is true, that He doesn't change, that I can't do anything to make Him love me more. He's loved me all that He can love. I can't imagine looking at my son and saying, son, I need you to be crucified because I love all these and they can't do it. How do I show you I love you anymore? There's no way. So if I'm going to produce good fruit, if I'm going to produce a crop, I've got to be set on that solid foundation. In verse 46, Jesus basically says, do we really believe? Is Jesus really Lord over all my life? He's asking you. You keep coming to me, but you don't do anything. You keep coming to me, but you've stopped maturing. You keep coming to me, but you said, well, this is as far as I'm going to go. So is Jesus Lord over all my life, every area? Is He Lord over my prayer time? Is He Lord over witnessing? Is He Lord over my family time? Is He Lord over my marriage? Is He Lord over my children, my relationship with my children? Is He Lord over my finances? Is He Lord over my job? Am I sold out completely to God, and can it be seen? Or is He a crutch? When I get sick and don't feel good, do I go lean on Christ? I think I told y'all this one time. I heard somebody say, A little boy went to his daddy and said, "Daddy, is that God's word?" And he said, "Well, yes, son, it is." He said, "The Bible there in the house?" He said, "Yes, son, that's the Bible." I said, "You know, that's God's word." And he said, "Well, you better give it back to him because we don't use it." Is he just a crutch? Is he a charm I rub in the morning or at night to say, "Lord, bless me, keep me safe, keep my family safe. Please bless my finances. Lord, please make us wealthy. Please bless my family. Everybody's traveling today, on and on, and now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep." And y'all are like, "Daniel, I don't pray like that." Well, is it some form of that? Or is Jesus just a religion? Is Jesus just the religion? Is he the thing that I say, "I'm a Christian"? "Oh, really? Wow. Wow. What makes you a Christian?" "Well, you see, I come to church regularly, and I tithe regularly, and, man, I go to Sunday school. And you won't believe this, but on Wednesday night after work, I go to that too. And I like other people. I don't want anything wrong. I love them, you know, and you know, I want things to happen. I even pray for them. I've been baptized. Man, I've been in this church all my life. My mom and daddy were good people. And they taught me right from wrong. And, you know, basically, I don't steal, I don't cheat, I don't do any of those things. I'm a Christian." Or are you coming to the Lord and saying, "Lord, what would you have me do? Well, this is it." And then you're like, no. That's what Jesus is asking. In verse 47, he says, "Well, if you can't understand this," Jesus says, "if he's truly the Lord, then this is what it'll look like." He said, "Suppose a man builds a house," all right? So every one of us is building a house. What is your house? Is this house your life? Yes. Is this house your relationship with the Lord? Yes. Is this house your relationship with others? Yes. Is this house your work, your witness, your testimony? Even as Brother Ronnie's funeral, and we had a testimony and saw of his life. Was that his house he built? Yes. It was not just where he physically resided. It was the house. And you heard the testimony. Is it your testimony? Yes. Based on what? It says you dig deep. You see, you can't just go with what feels good. You can't take just the prosperity gospel. You can't just say, "Oh, I'm sick, God doesn't love me." You've got to dig deeper than that. You got to get down to the basics. Because here's why. It says when the storms come. Did Jesus say if? Church, did Jesus say if? He said when. Because he also told his disciples, his apostles, when he began his journey to Jerusalem, he said the Son of Man will be betrayed. And he will be handed over to the Jewish leaders and to the Gentiles, and they'll crucify him. And he must suffer many things, but on the third day he'll rise again. Jesus, this is the same Jesus that told us, the student is not greater than the master. Right? And if the master suffers it, the student will as well. But you learn from the master. And if I'm to produce a crop, if I'm to build a house, if I'm to pick good fruit from a good tree, it's all ultimately got to be based on the foundation that Jesus is Lord of all, period. He is God alone, as Phillips, Craig, and Dean sing, "You are God alone, and I am not." And that's just the way it is, period. And my belief is in you. So he says, dig deep. What does that mean, Daniel? Paul breaks it down for us. In 2 Corinthians 13:5, he says, examine yourselves to see if your faith is genuine. Test yourself. Know if Christ is among you. Now, the Corinthians, they were like, we're followers of Paul. No, we're followers of Apollos. No, of Cephas. Kepha. No, we're followers of Christ. And Jesus said, Paul told him, listen, forget this. Examine yourself to see if you know the Lord and Jesus is among you. What does that mean for me, Daniel? That's to say, hey, do I know that I know that I know that I have trusted Christ alone, his sacrifice on the cross, his bloodshed for me, that cleanses sin once for all, And that is it. And that there is nothing I could do, no good works I could do, nothing to make him love me anymore. He's loved me all, and I'm just trusting in that. And that when my day comes, and it will, for his appointed man wants to die, and then the judgment, and I stand before him, and he says, why should I let you into my heaven, Daniel Coates? God, not because of anything I've done, but because all you did, and my faith in you. And this life that you've given me is not mine to live, but now it is Christ to live within me. Right? Because the storms will come. And there's a crop to be produced. There's labor to be done. You dig deep. James tells us in 2:17, listen, if your faith is built on Christ, works will follow. A crop will be produced. Do I know that I know that Jesus is my Savior? I have asked him to forgive me of my sin, cleanse and wash me of my sin, and that my faith is in him for eternal life, period. Plus nothing, minus nothing. I dug deep. Then it says you lay a foundation on the rock. You know, we just sang about cornerstone. I didn't plan that either, y'all. That just happened. That's the good Lord working things out. Jesus, the cornerstone. In Psalm 62, 5 and 6, this is what David said. This is when Jesus said, lay your foundation on the rock. That's what it means, on that solid rock. David says, let all that I am wait quietly before God, for my hope is in him. He alone is my rock, my salvation, my fortress. And that fortress is very critical in times of storm, where I will not be shaken just as the storms come. What are you depending on? Is your foundation firmly set on Christ, where you can build that house, that life, that testimony, that relationship, that crop? Well, Jesus loving us enough gives us the antithesis. He says, okay, I tell you what, just like you instruct your children, you say, all right, this is the way you're going to have to build this thing. This is the way you're going to have to work that machine. This is the way you're going to have to solve that problem. This is the way you're going to have to treat other people. And your kids are sitting there, and see, they don't know any different. And you're telling them. You say, if you do this, these are the good things that will come of it. Because I love you, I want to give you the good things, so I'm going to instruct you in the right way. But be wary. If you don't do them, these are the results. And too many today never get told there are consequences for bad behavior. And Jesus, and listen, I'm going to tell you this right now. This is hard for me to admit. This is very hard for me. Because yesterday, I'm wearing a badge, toting a gun, and getting cussed out from one end to the other, you know, trying to drag somebody to the car and listen to all this along the way. And it's tough to go from that, y'all. It is hard to flip to that and stand behind a pulpit. It's tough. So this message comes to me as well. You tell them those consequences I seen yesterday, folks don't understand or don't believe. Jesus does. So in verse 49, he tells us, okay, if you don't do it, here's what will happen. But anyone who hears, you're hearing the word, and he doesn't obey is like a person who builds a house without a foundation. When the floods sweep down against the house, it will be utterly destroyed. Not if, but when. I told a story this morning when me and Tracy first moved out to the farm and started and built a house. I needed me a little utility building to store all the stuff, you know, the weed eaters and all the tools and everything, the kids' toys. And I was like, you know something, as if I didn't have enough to do, I said, you know, I'm going to get the kit that you build instead of buying the one that could be delivering for. No, I'm going to build it. You know, I can do that myself. It's got the nails in it. It's got everything you need. So I'm going to do that. And Tracy, listen, you just stand over there, read the instructions to me, because I'm too smart to be able to do that. And you hand me the nails and the boards as that says put A to B, and you nail that through there. And so I'm doing that, you know. But there was one problem I didn't do. There's one thing I didn't do previous to going through the kit and start breaking it out. And what was that? Laying me a good firm foundation. No. I just got these little starter blocks and I laid them on the ground and here we go. Go to town. End of the day, I had it up. Done. Well, it's still standing. Don't get me wrong. It's still there. But the problem is you have to kick rocks out of the way or whatever to open the door up because it's none of that. Well, my daddy can't say nothing either. He had one delivered to him, but he didn't do that either. He put it on blocks too, and it's done the same thing. So I don't want to hear it. He's over there going, all right. I learned from my dad, see? That's what it was. Well, that's what happens. See, you tell somebody to do it. You're telling your kid, and up. See, when I was 16, I was probably like the rest of 16 through 18. Smartest you'll ever be in your whole life. Been around the world twice, know it all. Nobody can tell you anything. And I got four boys to go through it with. I already been through two girls. I got four boys to go through it with. And one of them's already there. This is what it says in Proverbs 2:12-15. The way of a fool is right in his own eyes. Can't tell him nothing. But he that hearkeneth unto the counsel is wise. So what did Jesus say? Daniel, build your life on the foundation. What is the foundation? Lord, I am the foundation. My way, my instruction, my love, my mercy, my forgiveness. Me in you, Daniel. I am the vine. You are the branch. Abide in me and you'll produce fruit. You'll produce the crop. You'll be the good tree. You'll be able to witness. Now listen, does that mean we don't fail or mess up? Remember the song Tracy just sang? There's no sin greater than grace. There's no sickness. There's no sorrow. There's no pain greater than grace. Well, do we believe it? Or do we say, no, I just need to work a little harder because if I do this, Jesus will love me more. No. Now, am I telling you not to work and go do those good things? Absolutely not. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying if you're doing it out of a heart, if I'm going to grow closer to God because he's going to love me a little more, because look, I did this and he didn't. Mm-mm. I love my children all the same. Don't you? And even if one messes up and one's faithful, do I love him any less? No, I mean, come on, the prodigal son. Jesus talked to us about that. Love him the same, and grace is always there. And if I know to do that, how much more my Father in heaven? Yes, you're going to have troubles. Yes, you're going to fall. Yes, you're going to be out of the way. There are times you're going to look back and say, man, I didn't listen. I should have listened. But, hey, that's called repentance. Praise the Lord for it. Lord, I'm sorry. And I want to turn back to you. The instruction you gave me, I didn't listen to. And that's my fault. I was stupid. God, will you forgive me? What is John 1:14? 1 John 1:14 says, confess your sins to the Lord, and he is faithful and just to forgive you of those sins. It's based on him. That foundation, those are the things where I'm talking to you about. Are you there? Or are you this? In Matthew 13:15, Jesus said, for this people's heart is grown callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see and hear and understand with their hearts and turn to me and be healed. Use what God has given you. Be faithful. Samuel told Saul, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission is better than offering. Rest on the Lord for everything. He is my all in all. He is my foundation. He is what I'm relying on, not to my glory, but to his be done. So it's time to apply it, and here we go. I can't begin to build without a solid foundation. It determines everything. Now I want you to know something. If you go to build, anybody who knows anything about build, whether you've bought a house, whether you've had one built, whether you're like me and building some barn, whatever it be, the foundation determines everything. Did you know the foundation determines the size and the shape of what's being built? It also determines the strength of what's being built. Now, if you watch a bricklayer or a mason, and they're going out and they're running their plumb line or liquid water level, they're running through there, they're laying that course just even, and they're staying within the foundation. If they get without, if you start building the bricks and you start getting out further than the foundation, what's going to happen? It's going to fall and collapse because it's not resting on that foundation. Now, I've used these analogies. What about your life? Is your life based on, is it within the bounds? Are you letting Jesus determine the size and the shape and the strength of your life, of your house? Is he determining it, or are you? Am I? I'm not going to be a hypocrite here and stand here and say, no, I got it all within. I am fully mature. I got it all going. I'm tracking. Not every day. And most time during the day, it's many times I'm, Lord, forgive me. I messed up again. And I'm going to stand here in need of your forgiveness one more time. And he's always there. Unbeliever, do you know him as your Savior? How do you know that there's a time that you're trusting in him alone? If not, I'll be here this morning.